Hello students, this is Mrs. Sonal Patil. In a previous class, we had begun with the chapter Transport in Plants, where we have studied up till plasmolysis. Today, we will begin with imbibition. Imbibition is a special type of diffusion when water is absorbed by solids, colloids, causing them to enormously increase in volume. So imbibition is nothing but it is the phenomenon of adsorption of water by the hydrophilic substance without forming a solution is called imbibition. The classical examples of imbibition are absorption of water by seeds and dry wood. The pressure that is produced by the swelling of wood had been used by prehistoric man to split rocks and boulders. If it were not for the pressure due to imbibition, seedlings would not have been able to emerge out of the soil into the open. They probably would not have been able to establish. Imbibition is also diffusion, since water movement is along a concentration gradient. The seeds and other such materials have almost no water, hence they absorb water easily. Water potential gradient between the absorbent and the liquid imbibed is essential for imbibition. In addition, for any instance to imbibe any liquid, for any substance to imbibe any liquid, affinity between the adsorbent and the liquid is also a prerequisite. So this, understand, imbibition is a special type of diffusion, okay, in which water is absorbed by solid particles, as I mentioned earlier, hydrophilic substances like solid particles of an adsorbent substance, causing the same to enormously increase in volume without producing any solution. So the solid adsorbent particles which cause imbibition or adsorption are called imbibents. Water or any other liquid which is absorbed is known as imbibate. During imbibition, water molecules are held over and in between the solid particles. In the process, water molecules lose their kinetic energy. The energy is released in the form of heat. It is also called heat of wetting. Imbibition causes swelling of imbibent. However, the increase in volume is less than the water imbibed. So this is the concept of imbibition. Coming to the next part, long distance transport of water. Long distance transport cannot occur by diffusion, though it can account for cell-to-cell movement of substances. Movement of molecules across a 50 micrometer cell by diffusion requires 0.5 seconds. Here also it's mentioned. So long distance transport of substances within a plant cannot be by diffusion, as I told you. An example is given as the movement of molecule across a typical plant cell takes approximately 2.5 seconds. In large and complex organisms, often substances have to be moved across very large distances. Sometimes the sites of production of absorption and sites of storage are too far from each other. Diffusion or active transport would not suffice. Special long distance transport systems become necessary so as to move substances across long distances and at much faster rate. Water and minerals and food are generally moved by a mass or bulk flow system. Mass flow is the movement of substances in bulk or en masse from one point to another as a result of pressure differences between the two points. It is a characteristic of a mass flow that substances, whether in solution or in suspension, are swept along at the same pace as in the flowing river. This is unlike diffusion, where different substances move independently depending on their concentration gradients. Bulk flow can be achieved either through a positive hydrostatic pressure gradient or a negative hydrostatic pressure gradient. Example, suction through a straw. So this long distance bulk transport of substances through conducting or vascular tissues is called as translocation. Remember, that we'll discuss here. So the bulk movement of substances through the conducting of or vascular tissues of plants is called translocation. The higher plants have highly specialized vascular tissues. It is xylem and phloem. You already know. Xylem is associated with the translocation of mainly water, mineral salts, some organic nitrogen and organic compound nitrogen and hormones from roots to the aerial parts of the plants. The phloem translocates a variety of organic and inorganic solutes mainly from the leaves to other parts of the plants. Now, how do plants absorb water? Terrestrial plants absorb water from soil. Soil water available for absorption is capillary water, which is present in soil micropores as thin film. Minerals occur both in the dissolved state as well as adsorbed over soil particles. Plant parts specialized for absorption of water and minerals are root hairs. So roots absorb most of the water that goes into the plant. Obviously, that is why we apply water to soil and not on the leaves. The responsibility of absorption of water and minerals is more specifically the function of the root hairs that are present in millions at the tip of the root. So root hairs helps in the absorption of the water. Root hairs are thin-walled, slender extensions of root epidermal cells that greatly increase the surface area for absorption. Water is absorbed along with mineral solutes by the root hairs purely by diffusion. Once water is absorbed by the root hairs, it can move deeper into root layers by two distinct pathways. So two pathways are involved here. The first one is apoplast pathway and the second is symplast pathway. The apoplast is a system of adjacent cell walls that is continuous throughout the plant, except at the Casparian strips of endodermis in the root. So in the endodermis of the root, there are Casparian strips, except that here the adjacent cell walls, that is nothing but the apoplast is a system of adjacent cell walls that is continuous throughout the plant. So apoplast is a non-living continuum formed of cell walls and intracellular spaces, whereas symplast is a living continuum formed of cytoplasms of cells connected by through plasmodesmata. So there is a difference between apoplast and the symplast pathway. Remember, apoplast pathway is nothing but it is cell-to-cell movement of water. Here takes place exclusively through the intracellular spaces and the walls of the cell. That is called as apoplast pathway. So plastic movement of water occurs exclusively through the intracellular spaces and the walls of the cell. Movement through the apoplast does not involve crossing the cell membrane. The movement is dependent on the gradient. The apoplast does not provide any barrier to water movement, and water movement is through mass flow. As water evaporates into intercellular spaces or the atmosphere, tension develops in the continuous stream of water in the apoplast. Hence, mass flow of water occurs due to adhesive and cohesive properties of water. The symplastic system is a system of interconnected protoplasts. Neighboring cells are connected through cytoplasmic strands that extend through plasmodesmata. During symplastic movement, the water travels through the cells, their cytoplasm. Intercellular movement is through the plasmodesmata. Water has to enter the cells through the cell membrane. Hence, the movement is relatively slower. Movement is again down a potential gradient. Symplastic movement may be aided by cytoplasmic streaming. Cytoplasmic streaming in cells of hydrilla leaf, the movement of chloroplast due to streaming is easily visible. Most of the water flow in the roots occurs via the apoplast, since the cortical cells are loosely packed and hence offer no resistance to water movement. However, the inner boundary of the cortex, The endodermis is pervious to water because of a band of subarized matrix called the Casparian strip. Water molecules are unable to penetrate the layer, so they are directed to wall regions that are not subarized. They are not subarized into the cells proper through the membranes. The water then moves through the symplast and again crosses a membrane to reach the cells of the xylem. Here the diagram shows you the pathway of water movement in the root. So symplastic pathway and apoplastic pathway is been shown. So remember, apoplastic pathway, cell-to-cell movement of water here takes place exclusively through the intercellular spaces and walls of the cell. Whereas symplastic pathway, cell-to-cell movement of water is occurring through plasmodesmata. Diagram important. So this is depicting the pathway of water movement in the root. Here also this is showing the pathways of water and ions, ion movement in the root. Here also the apoplastic pathway is being shown, how it is moving through the intercellular spaces, and then symplastic pathway is also been shown where cell to cell movement is occurring through the plasmodesmata. Just see how the water or the ions move inside the, starts from the root hairs and enters the root. The movement of water through root layers is ultimately symplastic in the endodermis. This is the only way water and other solutes can enter the vascular cylinder. Once inside the xylem, water is again free to move between cells as well as through them. In young roots, water enters directly into the xylem vessels or tracheids. These are non-living condyles and so are parts of the apoplast. Some plants have additional structures associated with them that help in water absorption. A mycorrhiza is a symbiotic association of fungus with the root system. The fungal filaments form a network around the young root or they penetrate the root cells. The hyphae have a very large surface area that absorb mineral ions and water from the soil. From a much larger volume of soil that perhaps a root cannot. The fungus provides minerals and water to the roots. In turn, the roots provide sugars and nitrogen containing compounds to mycorrhiza. So it is nothing but it is a symbiotic relationship being shown by the fungi. That is, fungal cells or the fungi are associated with the roots, and that is called as mycorrhiza. This is mycorrhiza. Some plants have an obligate association with the mycorrhizae. For example, pinus seeds cannot germinate and establish without the presence of mycorrhizae. So mycorrhiza is nothing but it is a symbiotic association of fungus with the root system, where both are benefited, root as well as the fungal members. Coming to the next part, that is root pressure. As various ions from the soil are actively transported into the vascular tissues of roots, water flows and increases the pressure inside the xylem. This positive pressure is called root pressure and can be responsible for pushing up water to small heights in the stem. This or you can say that this theory or root theory also was been proposed by Presley. Root pressure is a positive pressure found in the xylem canal of some plants due to metabolic activity of their roots. There is an active water absorption which creates sufficient pressure to push water upwardly. A root pressure of 1 to 2 bars is common. Higher values have also been reported here. Root pressure develops due to the active water absorption caused by, firstly, accumulation of the sugar or salts in the xylem canals, secondly, maintenance of bioelectric potential or membrane potential, thirdly, pumping of salts, sugar or water by cells through surrounding xylem canals. Effect of root pressure is also observed at night and early morning when evaporation is low and excess water collects in the form of droplets around special openings of veins near the tip of grass blades and leaves of many herbaceous parts. Such water loss in its liquid phase is known as guttation. So guttation here is nothing but you can root pressure is maximum during, as I told you early morning, it is maximum. So root pressure is maximum during early morning of spring and rainy season, when droplets of water ooze out from leaf tip of grasses and leaf margins of many herbaceous plants, and this phenomena is called as guttation. So this is the loss of water in the form of droplets, that is called as guttation. Root pressure can at best only provide a modest push in the overall process of water transport. They obviously do not play a role, major role in water movement up tall trees. The greatest contribution of root pressure may be to re-establish the continuous chains of water molecules in the xylem, which often break under the enormous tension created by transpiration. Root pressure does not account for majority of water water transport. Most plants meet their need by transpiration pull. Now, what is this transpiration pull? Despite the absence of heart or circulatory system in the plant, the flow of water upward through the xylem in plants can achieve fairly high rates, up to about 15 meters per hour. How is this movement accomplished? A long-standing question is whether water is pushed or pulled through the plant. Most researchers agree that water is mainly pulled through the plant, and that the driving force for this process is transpiration from leaves. This is referred to as cohesion tension transpiration pull model of water transport. But what generates is what generates this transpiration pull? What is transient? Water is transient in plants. Less than 1% of water reaching the leaves is used in photosynthesis and plant growth. Most of it is lost through the stomata in the leaves. This water loss is known as transpiration. So transpiration is nothing but it is a loss of water in the form of water vapor through the aerial parts of the plant is called as transpiration. Because of this transpiration, tension is created in the xylem column, and that pulls, that is nothing, it creates a pulling force that is called as transpiration pull. Now transpiration, as I told you, it is an evaporative loss of water by plants. It occurs mainly through the stomata in the leaves. Besides the loss of water vapor in transpiration, exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the leaf also occurs through pores called stomata. Normally, stomata are open in the daytime and closed during the night. The immediate cause of the opening or closing of stomata is a change in the turgidity of the guard cells. The inner wall of each guard cell towards the pore or stomatal aperture is thick and elastic. When turgidity increases within the two guard cells flanking each stomatal aperture or pore, the thin outer walls bulge. They bulge out and force the inner walls into crescent shape. The opening of the stoma is also aided or helped due to the orientation of the microfibrils in the cell walls of the guard cells. Cellulose microfibrils are oriented radially rather than longitudinally, making it easier for the stoma to open. When the guard cells lose turgor due to water loss, the elastic inner walls regain their original shape. The guard cells become flaccid and stoma closes. Usually, the lower surface of dorsiventral leaf has a greater number of stomata, while the isobilateral leaf, which is present in monocots, they have equal number of stomata on both the surfaces. So remember, dicots are called as dicot leaf is called as dorsiventral leaf. It has more number of stomata present in the lower surface, whereas in the monocots, which is called as isobilateral leaf, they have equal number of stomata on both the surfaces. Transpiration is affected by several external factors like temperature, light, humidity, wind speed. Plant factors that affect transpiration include number and distribution of stomata, percent of open stomata, water status of the plant, canopy, structure, etc. The transpiration-driven ascent of xylem sap depends mainly on the following physical properties of water. First is cohesion. Mutual attraction between the water molecules is called as cohesion. Attraction of water molecules to polar surface is called as adhesion. Surface tension is nothing but water molecules are attracted to each other in the liquid phase more than to water in the gas phase. These properties give water high tensile strength, that is an ability to resist a pulling force, and high capillarity, that is ability to rise in thin tubes. In plants, capillarity is aided by small diameter of tracheal elements, that is the tracheids and the vessel elements. Here is a diagram showing the stromatal aperture, which is comprising of guard cells. An opening is there, which is called a stromatal pore, and as I told you, the inner walls of the guard cells are thick compared to the outer walls, and then these guard cells are surrounded by the subsidiary cells. So this is the structure of stromata, important diagram. The process of photosynthesis requires water. The system of xylem vessels from the root to leaf vein can supply the needed water. As water evaporates through the stromata, since the thin film of water over the cells is continuous, it results in pulling of the water molecule by molecule into the leaf from the xylem. Also, because of lower concentration of water vapor in the atmosphere as compared to the substromatal cavity and interstellar spaces, water diffuses into the surrounding air. This creates a pull. Measurements reveal that the forces generated by transpiration can create pressure sufficient to lift a xylem-sized column of water over 130 meters high. Here is a diagram shown of water movement in the leaf. So it is showing the water movement in the leaf. Where you can see here how the water diffuses out of the as water vapors, path followed by the water molecules has been shown, thin film of water, okay, and guard cells, stromatal opening. So through the stromata you can just see how the exchange of gases has been occurring. So this is showing you the water movement of the in the leaf. So today we'll stop here, and in the next class we'll begin with the next part of this chapter. Thank you.